a lot of different things. Some, there have been a couple stations, not that many. The FCC believes that all stations are on because they're frustrated DJs who just aren't good enough to get jobs. And they aren't good enough to make it in the commercial segment, so they have to resort to pirating. That's what they think, but there have been only a couple stations like that. Most of them are just people, either DJs or regular people or whatever, who have an interest in radio and they want to put on whatever they put on. Some of them like to get letters. Some of them, you know, for the notoriety. But a lot of them just like to put on what they want to do.
And pirate radio?
Why? It's fun. It's a freedom of expression that's a lot freer than the radio stations that are out there. I don't know. It's exciting. It beats the heck out of regular radio. Regular radio is pretty poor, pretty stagnant, I'd say. That's about it. Why do you do it, Radio Animal?
Why do I do it?
<'Cause you're laughs>
Looking at that funny
right?
face over there. Well, it goes beyond deeper than that, than just maybe something I could talk about in a few sentences, I would say, but I guess it's a combination of technology coming together with, you know, the fact that I know about electronics. I'm interested in communication.
And there isn't any free broadcasting stuff around. There's no free broadcaster. To be a broadcaster, you actually have to have a lot of money and good moral standings and the works. And there just isn't any free broadcasting license or anything.
Harry Aness from Radio Flatus here, bringing you a live broadcast and a videotaped interview with both the radio stations Wolf Radio International, or is it Radio Wolf International?
Yep, Radio Wolf International.
Our Wolf Eyes. And
I'm seeing
Sparky from Queso, and of course, I'm Harry Aness from Radio Flatus.
Coming to you from a leaky boat somewhere in the Bermuda Triangle, this is Tangerine Radio. And tonight, Tangerine Radio presents a special program, Adventures in Anarchy.
The next train arrives on here at 5:09. I'm standing where my daddy used to be.
Okay, it's pretty much, you know, there are just as many people, different people, as there are in different interests. There are just as many different stations, and they're generally highly individualized. And there are some stations that play folk music, some stations that play hard rock music, there are heavy metal stations, there are punk stations, there are stations that don't play music and just have talk shows. There are anarchist stations, there are just liberal stations, there are right-wing stations, Nazi stations, you name it.
If you had a station, what would you program?
There's an hour for time on a major shortwave station, in fact.
Yeah, there's not many rock and roll shortwave stations. There's only, what, two in the United States anyways. There's KUSW and WRNO, and their selection's real bad. They play the top 40s that nobody else really wants to hear, because we've heard it a million times before. But there's hardly any shortwave stations that play exclusively rock and roll, and KUSW, like I said, and WRNO are the only ones. But I think they're paralleled with FM, but they play top 40 stuff, and that's not really what pirate radio people do. Pirate radio people usually play obscure...
I'm sorry about that.
Obscure music that you usually don't hear on the radio, or things that you've heard in the past, and been played a lot and then discontinued. A lot of that stuff is redone.
We try to go into it with a little bit of, subject to go by.
That's about it. Outline of the whole thing. That's the best, I think.
A subject going into it and writing a little bit out on it.
Right. Oh, okay.
Radioflatus is usually done, very well produced. We use a PC. We write the scripts up.
PC?
Yeah.
You guys got money. We don't use PC.
I'll sit around or get our chances on the PC and add little bits in here, make little changes, re-edit it. The final copy would come out, and then we'd print out enough, and we'd all sit around the mic reading our lines. It went over pretty well. I mean, it was well produced. Our first show with
these interval signals. Their interval signals are mostly for. Their interval signals are mostly to hold up the frequency. Usually, some of them, so that nobody else gets on them, which has been known to be done by pirates. When they're not using them, they use an interval signal for a half hour or so.
Radioflatus does not have an interval signal. We always start off with just music. We haven't worked out one yet. We put on a couple songs before we actually go on the air with the meat of our program, what we're going to be talking about or what the theme's going to be.
You turn on your dial and you're going to find it.
Yeah.
You should never know when the fire's going to be on. You should always be sporadic. Never repeat himself or follow any patterns.
We already went through the pattern.
Otherwise, you know, he's looking for trouble.
Real sporadic,
Busted like that guy did twice. But
you got to be real sporadic.
And the interval signal gives him a chance to...
Usually,
a pirate will come on the top of an hour, maybe a half hour. Some people might even go a quarter hour, I don't know. Most of the time, every half hour and check the radio, and there's a good chance we're going to find someone starting on. Whoever lives on it, his body.
Give me some of that cow can over there in the corner.
This hat. My dog food.
Are you almost done with the song?
No, a little bit left. Just have to keep. And I'm ready with Moody Blues, the story. Got that on there?
Yeah.
Moody Blues.
Now it's done. So, let's get it right. The song's going to end any second.
It fades,
and then who's going to get the mic?
I can start.
You can do introductions.
Just
let it go. Whatever you're going to do. Think of it right now.
Okay. I'll say I'm sitting in with, you know, then you guys can say hi. And what to whatever you want.
So,
do you want to get the ad group too? Yeah. We want to talk a little bit first.
Okay. MasterCard, by everyone does, give them a call, buy the video.
All right, great. You'll see us on here.
Don't wait for the movie.
This broadcast here. Yeah, we'll be talking, speaking of movies, we will be talking about the new Pump Up the Volume movie. Actually, it's been out, I would say, a month, and it's been talked about for about 6 months in the pirate community, but we're going to be doing a little review, also be playing a few songs from that movie. Right now, here are the Moody Blues to take us in to a brand new era of broadcasting with yours truly, Radio Animal, Sparky from KZAP, and Harry A. Ness from Radio Flatus. That was, by the way, from Radio Flatus. What kind of instrument were you using?
A Mother's Baldwin organ.
Okay. Oh, hey, that sounds good.
Don't say that too fast.
And
one of those Rube Goldberg units.
It's amazing that the drum little solo was actually heard. It was actually fingers tapping on the wood grain. And it seemed to go over well the first time it was broadcast back in February 25th and March 5th of 1990.
Oh, a lot of folks liked it, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Great, great. Good to hear it.
What do you got up next here?
Oh, well, this is some things that...
Some things?
KZAP, well, I would say, you know, parody sort of bits. Promos, yeah, parodies, that KZAP has been famous for throughout the years. Now, tell us about this bit a little bit.
Oh, everybody liked this. This is kind of a parody on Barbie, the doll Barbie, and having her mate Ken and so on and so forth. But people have heard this, so I think it was about a year ago I played this.
Yeah.
So everybody liked it. I got rave reviews about this one.
But there's one they like better. I saw it in your reports.
Tony Orlando and Dawn of the Living Dead?
That's right.
We'll have to get that one later on, too.
Is it on this tape?
Somewhere.
Okay. We're making a special broadcast right now of Radio Wolf International. This is not just an event.
Being taped live, video-wise.
Well, video, audio, and just about every other way, too, probably ways that we don't even know. Maybe in the cosmic realm as well, I just don't know about those things. But speaking of the Moody Blues, you know, they were deeply into that stuff. However, we are doing many different things. And also, I'd like to mention that it's a celebration, sort of my birthday of yesterday.
How old are you, Radio Alan?
It's my silver anniversary of living, not of pirate radio, but of being on this earth, 25 years.
25 years.
How long has pirate radio been a part of your life, Radio Animal?
Oh, gee, I don't know. It's coming up on about 10 now, I believe.
About 24.5 of those years, probably.
Yeah, maybe. But I would say from the first beginnings, probably about 10 years, approximately, nowadays. Even though dogs and wolves have been a lot longer, just to tell you, give you some input there for the new station. Here's your spot. What is it? Sparky.
Tony Orlando. Oh, no, that's not it. Barbo.
Package.
I mentioned also that you can write to us at the mail drop address. We have a little... I'll be playing you something about that.
What is the mailbox address? Is this
about 20 or 9?
No, it's not the 109 one. It's the doghouse one, isn't it?
Yeah. That's you can write to Radio Wolf International. And if you write in large block letters that won't fit across the front of an envelope, then just write RWI. Of course, this is no relation to Radio Woodland International either.
RWI?
Radio Waves International.
Or Radio Waves International. He's going to have to write this, huh? You're going to have to print that this is the third time the name of a station has been used. I saw one of your other lists. But nonetheless, it's not related to Radio Woodlands International or any of those other RWIs out there, because this is Radio Wolf International.
Yes, it is. And what have we got up here? Kiss.
Kiss.
Is this from a long time ago when they wore the makeup and they looked like the Ultimate Warrior?
Yeah, I believe it's some of their early 80s material, before the Unmasked album, in fact. It's called I Love It Loud. This is from Smashes, Thrashes, and Hits. That's the name of the album, so I don't know what the original has come from, but you want to
Simmons show his tongue on this one?
I don't remember. I don't have the album right here. We have it off of a chrome tape version here. You are listening, by the way, to Radio Animal. Once again, Sparky from KZAP.
WKZP.
WKZP. That's not KZAP. As they were we'll talk about that later, by the way, Sparky. They were compared to in that issue of Popular Communications. Anyway, here's Kiss on your rock and roll radio orgy to steal something from Garbanzo! Napoleon the 14th. They're coming to take me away. Yeah, you seem to know something about this, Harry. When did this song come out? You said you couldn't find a copy of this anymore.
Actually, I've only heard the song a couple times, and that was on a Dr. Demento show.
Oh, yeah, he's played it often.
That's about the most legal program that can be... It seems like it could be a pirate, easily.
Yeah, and I don't think it's ever been on the bands before, believe it or not. Heck, Radio Candy, the John Candy program has been on. Also, Pirate Radio KQLZ in Los Angeles.
Oh, really?
Some of that show would be great for rebroadcasting on pirate radio.
I would think so. What's that again?
They have done Radio Candy before.
Yeah, we've heard that. That was on 1619 one time. I remember an old logging. Here's Napoleon the 14th.
They're coming to take us away.
And what station is this?
Wolf International.
Yes.
WKZP, that's KZAP. This is Harry A.S. talking to you through a Mr. Microphone. And have a good time here at the broadcast. We're going into our second side of the tape. In case you caught that little pause there, that was actually us flipping the tape. And in case you didn't notice, the transmitter never went down. Yeah, I'd like to hear reports about how well that's going out. We'll get the address a little bit later on. If you heard us well, I'd like to hear about it. If not, I'd still like to hear about it. Write in, give us what you heard, a standard letter, and we'll give you a standard QSL. Right now, we got a little bit of homebrew here.
Sort of. Actually, I probably have that stuff locked away somewhere.
What about that Pump Up the Volume movie? Did you go see it?
I saw it. I sure did. We went, about five of us pirates went at once. We all sat in the row, in one row of the theater. We were up a little bit too close to the screen. I was a bit overwhelmed, and that's my review of the film.
You didn't like it? Is that what you were saying? Did you
like it? I liked it. I'm in jail. Because of it.
Yeah, you never know. Somebody might just take up pirating, and that's what will happen. But
actually,
fortunately,
I think a lot of people are going to do that. I hope a lot of people do.
How come it doesn't seem like your microphone's on? You're not talking.
I didn't have it
talking.
Loud enough.
Oh.
It was you were still being caught, but I wasn't loud enough. Like I said, it was a good movie.
Was it inspiring?
I would say it's inspiring. Man, I keep getting this.
You just like it, Sparky, because you're really Christian Slater.
Oh, I am. You didn't know that.
No, was that disguise on?
By disguise.
Whoa.
I don't have a cigarette in my hand though.
Mm-hmm.
You notice he smoked a lot.
Oh yeah, he did.
Shirt off, and no, there's
Start
no women
like
taking their shirt off with
yeah,
you.
Yeah, how come in the movie there's like fair-breasted women, and I'm looking at like you.
For listeners' sake, it is really not that glamorous in pirate radio. I mean, girls do not pull off their shirts when I was talking to the microphone, and neither does Sparky.
Well, you never know. But I tell you what, Andrew will tell you there have been cases of listener letters that have been pretty juicy.
Just the programming stuff.
Well, mostly it's residential type studio equipment, something you can buy, most of it. Semi-professional, probably, I would say, the mixer.
Yeah, everybody
is.
Can probably pick it up from any normal stereo outlet or whatever.
Yeah, music store type of thing.
So it's just conventional stereo equipment.
Yeah, because you don't have to have the type acceptance.
Some of it's reworked.
The FCC requires.
Some of it's a little bit reworked.
Hey, that's good.
Hey, we're haunted.
Action.
Yeah. But some of it's reworked to accept some of the levels that got to go into the radios that we buy. Now, of course, we buy the radios mostly from Hamfests for minimal prices, usually less than $100, which isn't too bad to get a station on for $100 and be heard around the world.
If someone wants to get on pirate radio, what does he first have to do to do it?
Yeah, you can do a couple different things. Either you can contact a station and try to air a tape of your own station. And if that's the case, there have been stations who put together programs just on a cassette box that has two recorder sections, so that they record their announcements over the mics and they have double cassette to record things across. That's how low budget it can be. You can pick those up for $30 new. Or you can set up your own station, get a transmitter and have whatever kind of recording equipment and go to it. Okay, for shortwave, it's a shortwave transmitter, usually an old ham rig that is severely outdated and that nobody wants anymore. They have hams used to operate on AM modulation, which is what the AM broadcast band uses. Since then, in the 60s, they went to single sideband, which is just a little chunk of AM. It's like if AM was this big, single sideband is just like a little piece of it. And most people that hear it say that it sounds kind of like ducks. And likewise, the audio for music is really bad. But the big reason why people do it is because a little bit of power gets out a long ways. So anyway, all this old AM equipment is now totally defunct. Nobody wants it. And you can pick up a radio that might have cost $200 in 1963. You can pick it up for maybe $25.
No need to try when you've got money.
Beer that made Boise famous.
This weekend featuring Triplum, jazz, swing, rock and roll, and blues are just part of what Triplum features.
Immigrants. Who are they? Where did they come from? wide.
All the same old day.
Tonight on Vinco Channel 7, the dramatic conclusion of East of Pittsburgh. A group of college students and a military officer meet together in a small production studio in central Pennsylvania and attempt to create programming for an illegal radio station. It stars Stan Thomas as Frank, Ben Dover as Charles, and Senator Robert Byrd as William Kyle. That's the conclusion of East of Pittsburgh, tonight on Vinco Channel 7.
Well, I guess first they'd have to have an interest in radio, at least to some extent. And I don't know, probably a little more thinking in nature. Who would think about, you know, things before they do them, not just a wild partying type, because there's too much. There's not enough feedback. You don't get the direct interaction with pirate radio that you do with something else, with like graffitiing a building or something. When you do pirate radio, you don't find out about it until like a week later. You don't get your mail until maybe a week later or whatever, maybe 2 weeks later. You might get a couple calls from friends, or maybe you can call a couple friends after it, but that's it. There is no immediate thrill from doing it. So people who are wild and crazy would get into cliff diving or whatever, but not pirate radio. Okay. Just because they like their doing it. I know one station that is currently putting out the best signal of any pirate around, Hope Radio. They've gotten hundreds of reports, but they didn't have an address for about 4 or 5 months. And for that time, he was on a lot. I heard him probably 15 times. Usually with great signals, as good as a local AM station, great audio, and that whole time he didn't really know if anybody was hearing him. And he'd even been heard in Europe, and he didn't know if anybody was hearing him or not. And so I wrote back to him, and he like called me the next day and was like, people are hearing me. Okay, I personally just use a Sony 2010 receiver, and they still make them. I bought mine used, and I got it pretty cheap, and it's a really great radio. I saw some friends who had them, and I tried it, and I like it a lot. And I don't want to plug Sony too much, but I like the radio a lot, and it does a good job for pirates. And all I use is this hooked up to some wire, about 100 feet of wire, and I think it does a good job. And the reason I use this is because it's a good radio, and I'm pretty cheap. So, between the two, I like what it does. It seems to do a good job with pirates, because I hear about as many as anybody else in the country. Okay. Right here is, well, here's a log of RFM. I just showed the picture of that, so that's kind of suitable. Anyway, I keep the time in Universal Time Coordinated, which is UTC, and that goes by the standard atomic clock, which is in France somewhere. It changed. It used to be in Greenwich, England. And so that, what that time means is it's like 5 hours up, and it never changes daylight or normal time. And so right now it's Eastern Daylight Time. So 0210 would be 10:10 p.m. And I just log the times and then the information. I'm not sure what songs they were. RFM plays a lot of new age jazz selections, and to tell you the truth, I'm not up on the titles of new age jazz music, but you know, I abbreviated BRS address, ADD, Blue Ridge Summit address, and just some of the things that they said or some of the ads, like there, you're listening to RFM. Can you feel us? Can you feel us at all? That was a parody of Radio Clandestine, which usually says, can you hear us? Can you hear us at all? So they're saying, can you feel us? Try to keep pretty good notes, because this is all you have to remember these stations by. And in even a week, the station might never be on again. It might be gone forever. The one broadcast you hear from a station might be its only one. And who knows, it might be a very good station that you'll want to remember. And even if it isn't, you can at least research it, you know, years later, find out that so-and-so ran such and such a station you heard way back when.
Anything else?
It's good to keep stuff on tape if you can. I know one guy who, he was 13, I think, and he heard the voice of the Purple Pumpkin in 1970. And that's like one of the very old pirate stations. And he happened to think enough to pull out his parents' reel-to-reel tape player and record some of the broadcast. And because of that, he still has it on tape, and he still listens to pirate radio, and that's very, very important to him. And because of that, you know, like, I got a copy of it, and some other people do, and it's really, really rare. Nobody else has anything from that station. Okay, well, usually I just write down, I write just like an intro, a little intro to it, saying I heard your station on this day, and then I write down what I wrote down in my logbook, and have the station, the frequency that it operated on, the day that it was on, the times that I heard it, and then the information about the things that I heard. And then I go through and usually make some comments about other things, like maybe I'll say, you know, the frequency was good that night and things were coming through pretty well, or maybe it was fading or whatever, and I'll just say a little bit about it, how it was coming in, and I say tell a little bit about myself, what I was listening on, you know, the type of radio that I had. And then I usually say some program comments, whether I like the program or not, or what I thought they could do to improve the program, or, you know, just a few things like that, just to try to give them a little bit. And then I tell them a little bit about myself with, like, what I do for a living, you know, maybe favorite stations, whatever. And not too many people do that kind of thing, and I think that's kind of a shame. Most of them just want the QSL card, and I think it's pretty important, since this is such a personal hobby, that people should write personal letters, at least to some extent. I used to type them all up, and that got too much. Now I write them all out handwritten, and usually that's pretty sloppy. And if I'm getting really desperate, I'll photocopy and then write a note with it. And photocopying usually isn't too good for me, because I write pretty sloppy in my logbook, and I can read it, but a lot of people can't. Usually you send it to a mail drop, which is someone who owns a post office box, who gets the mail from a station and sends it off to the station then. And it's always important to enclose 3 25-cent stamps, because otherwise the mail drops, well, they might not get upset with you, but you won't be one of their favorites.
If you did not get a response.
Well, there are some stations who don't QSL at all, and they don't respond, even though they give out an address. WPOT did that, like, I guess around 82. I have a couple stations right now. The voice of Radio Free Indiana never reported to anyone. They got a lot of mail. They never responded to any of it. They never even responded to me, even though I was forwarding mail for them. And another station is CRUD, K-R-U-D, which I am the mail drop for, and which never responded to anyone. And people, you know, I get letters, you know, from people who don't know, and they wonder if it's because of my fault. And it's not me. It's them.
That's amazing.
But it's pretty good, considering, you know, with legal stations and stuff, they're lucky if they ever get any letters.
Yeah.
And the little pirate station just gets flooded.
Now, do you find that people who write in basically say the same thing, or is there differences? And this person heard
Yeah, I find there are a lot of differences, not so much just from people writing in, but from doing my logs. I'll be writing through, and you know, there'll be one guy will hear one thing, and I'll read through, and somebody will hear something completely different. And with the static and stuff, it just really. Sometimes I even find out that people don't hear what they think they're hearing. And like I've heard the broadcast too, and then I'll see reported, and I'll know what I heard, and I'll know that somebody else, you know, just goofed up, either
is
with
that
a name
an
or
honest mistake?
Yeah. There isn't a whole lot of cheating and reporting anymore. There used to be, you know, people would copy out of a newsletter and write in for a QSL, and be, you know, just pretty low about it, and try to get QSLs out of stations. But there hasn't been a whole lot of that lately. Okay, the QSL card signifies that you actually heard the broadcast. And pirate listening is a little different than shortwave listening, even though a lot of times it is the same thing. Most people who want pirate QSLs want them because, you know, they're fun and interesting and stuff. Most people who collect shortwave QSLs do it kind of as a competitive kind of sport, kind of a radio sport. And but you have people who have heard just about everything on shortwave, so they get into pirates because they're a challenge. And some of those people just want to have QSL cards, and they want them more for the number than that they really care about the station at all. So there are a lot of different things that way. And sometimes you might not feel like QSLing, or you might hit one in a bad mood, and he might just decide to throw your report away. Most of them are pretty nice, and they really like getting mail. And usually they'll send you a card. Some of them even send letters with their cards. And, you know, they're generally pretty nice. They're just radio hobbyists, just like most people listening.
How much time does a pirate usually spend in responding to
us? It depends on the station. You know, a station might not get any mail in, you know, 10 minutes, and other station might get tons of mail. The radio animal, we're going to be going to his place, and he's a horrible example of that. He liked to type up full page letters to everybody who wrote to him, and because of that, a lot of people it would take him months to get in to get his stuff out, just because he felt that he really had to write everybody a full letter. And so he was really good that way in some ways. Not good with the speed.
What's the typical response time?
No, usually because of the forwarding and everything. Usually about 60 days, anywhere from 30 to 60 is pretty good to average. Some stations, Radio Clandestine, they usually took like 200 days. And part of it was because of how much mail they got. You know, right now Hope Radio, they've QSL'd maybe 10 people, and they've been on for 10 months, and they've probably been heard by, I don't know, maybe 300 people, and they're just starting to get their QSL cards out because they've spent so much other time broadcasting and not writing reports. Voice laryngitis.
So when you get a QSL, it goes right into a book or a photo album like that?
Yeah, I put them in just because I think they're kind of rare and valuable.
Is that what should be done with the QSL?
I used to have them on my wall for a while. I've got so many, and we don't have a lot of room to put them up on the wall right now. It's kind of neat to put them in books, because then I can take them around and show people, like here. If I had them on the wall, I'd have to rip them all off. Or it's kind of hard to photocopy a wall, too.
So, would you advise somebody to do that?
Yeah, take care of them, because you might never get one again, especially the really nice ones. Some of the photocopy ones aren't so great, but the ones that are really interesting or whatever, you know, in even 6 months, the station might never respond to mail again. They might get busted, and they'll lose interest, or they might just decide that they don't want to write anybody anymore, and that's it. A good one. WJDI. That's the transmitting room. And the transmitter is on the right. And it's all home built, and he spent $9,000 on it. And it puts out, I guess, about between, I'm not sure, it was 1,500 watts, but I heard that he got it up to 3,000 watts. And apparently, he has the audio broadcast quality. So it is basically a transmitter from a broadcast station, except it's homemade. And he said he's a broadcast engineer, so.
That's atypical.
Very. this station operated just above the AM band and was heard like in Kansas, and he gave his location as New York. And he came through stronger than most clear channel AM broadcast stations. You know, he came through better than a lot of 50 kilowatt stations just because of his frequency and his antenna and everything. And it's just pretty incredible. Yeah. That's RFM. And to the side is the operator, HV Short. And he's got his equipment right there. He's got an old Viking Challenger transmitter from like 63 or whatever. And you know, he really doesn't have much equipment. He spent $30 on his transmitter. He just tapes everything on a box, and it's not much. Okay, well, one thing is a pirate radio book, which is out on TRA Publications, and it's written by George Zeller, and it comes out, here is a press release from it. It comes out every year. It's called the Pirate Radio Directory, and it features all the stations that had been on in the previous year. And it's really good to get kind of an overview about the pirate radio scene. And he has a few things about pirate radio that are pretty handy, like contacting mail drops, a lot of cool stuff like that. And George is an authority on pirate radio. And I forgot to mention George earlier with being one of the mentors of the scene, because he doesn't do anything to support it. He writes a lot of letters to people, but he doesn't, you know, go on about how pirate radio is the thing to do, you know, start one up or anything like that. But he really likes to listen to stations, and he puts out the directory, and in a way, that's a real boost to the scene with that. And Monitoring Times, which you have the copy over there with Ian McFarland, it has I have one here too. Has Outer Limits column in, written by John Sanisuoso. I believe I got that pronounced right. I hope so. That's a good column. And I guess in a way he's a pirate mentor too, because he's been writing that column for a few years, and he's been writing columns in different radio clubs for like 10 years about pirate radio. So he does a lot for it. And let's see some other things here that cover pirate radio. Popular Communications is another glossy magazine that you can find in newsstands. And it has a pirate column in called The Pirate's Den. And the things to remember about these magazines are that they're a little bit out of date because of the time that it takes to publish them, so that they won't be right up to date. Popular Communications is usually 5 or 6 months behind, and that definitely hurts things with pirate radio as much as it changes. But they do have some good articles on pirate radio. Tom Nitel writes some. He's the editor, and he writes some good overview articles, have nice pictures in and stuff that you can't get it with the newsletter. So in that sense, they really are good. But the primo pirate magazine in the United States is the Ace. And it covers pirate radio, clandestine stations, which are political stations that try to overthrow governments, that are completely different from pirate stations usually, although sometimes they border on each other. And spy number stations, which are spy stations who broadcast groups of numbers in code. That's what it covers, and it's got a lot of good columns in it. And it's a great newsletter that's up to date and covers almost everything you'd ever want to know about pirate radio.
Well, let me tell you a story about Fearless Fred, a radio pirate who kept his finals red. And then one night he did a show with Harry, and in through the door stormed the FCC. Buzz, that is, radio police, federal corporate coddlers, yeah. The first thing you know, Fearless Fred got red. He picked up a mic stand and beat him nearly dead. When he looked down his foresight, they started to disperse. So he touched up both barrels and shouted them a curse. Get the fuck out of here. Take your shoes off. Y'all can run faster that way.
Radio Garbanzo.
Newest.
Buck?
Yeah, it's me.
What the? How'd you get our phone number?
Because it's my phone, dumbass. Remember? You yanked my car phone out of my Mercedes.
Yeah, don't sweat it, Buck. I didn't steal it. I just borrowed it.
As far as I'm concerned, you stole it.
No way, Buck. It's still in your name, along with the bills.
What, you rotten, ingrate ass?
What can I do for...
Okay, they pinpoint by, there are a bunch of monitoring stations around the country. They have a good bit of high-tech equipment, and by taking the readings, figuring out approximately what direction a pirate station is coming from, with a few different readings from around the country, they can pretty well locate a station within maybe a 20-mile radius, 15-mile radius, something like that. So in that respect, they're doing pretty well. And the problem is they have to drive out and actually find the station. Okay, then they send out their agents in cars. And they're usually, from what I've heard, they're usually nondescript, you know, Chevy Malibus, cars like that. And they don't have big antenna masts or anything on them. They have the antennas built right into the ceiling. And from what I've heard, usually the passenger side seat is missing, and they have a bank of equipment in there. The guy who's with the agent sits in the back seat and works the equipment knobs from the back seat. That's what I've heard. Apparently that's true in at least most occasions. Anyway, they send them out, and they can be... it's a lot more dangerous to pirate if there just happens to be a new local legal station coming on the air. Say, if a station would be on the air from... I don't know, whatever town, any town USA, if a pirate was on from there, and there was a new station that just happened to be, new legal station just happened to be coming in on into any town, it's bad to broadcast because the FCC agents are going to be there. The monitors from around the country are going to hear it, and they're going to say, you know, this pirate is coming from somewhere around any town, and then they're going to call up their agents who are in any town who are checking, working on that legal transmitter site, taking meter readings and all that kind of fun stuff. They're going to call them up and they're going to say, hey, there's a pirate in your area. They're on such and such a frequency. Go out and get them. And, you know, if the station's a block away, you know, and it's probably not a good idea to assault the agents or anything like that. Probably the best thing to do is be nice to them. And depending on the circumstances, there are a lot of things depend on the circumstances. If you act real nice to him, really nice, like the radio animal, he was nice to him, not just because he was trying to act nice, but just because he's nice in general. He was just nice to him, and they really lowered his fine because they took his situation into account. And if you're really mean to them, they'll give you everything they have. If you sick dogs on them and punch them and stuff, it's not a good idea. They'll fine you and they'll do anything they can. So it's either act nice or just kind of ignore them. You know, say, I didn't do anything wrong. You don't even know that I pirated. that's probably a good way. If you have the money, you make them take them to court, take you to court, and they might not win. Well, and in that respect, if it's late at night, it's probably not good to have any lights on in the house if you're broadcasting. I don't know. Well, you don't have to leave them in. That's one thing, unless they have a search warrant. And if there aren't any lights on at the time, you don't have to leave them in. For all they know, nobody's in the house. That's probably one of the best things to do, because if you leave them in your house, they're going to check out your equipment and see that it's on the right frequency, that the tubes are hot. Those are pretty good indications, especially if they have your voice on tape, which they probably will. So voice disguisers are probably actually a pretty good idea, too, to use harmonizers, digital, whatever, digital processing. There are all kinds of fun things out on the market that help disguise voice, and the radio animal has one over at his house that I can show you. It's a toy put out by Hio Art, and he got it on sale for $20 in a toy store.
You know, it's sort of something, I guess, that you kind of think might happen sometime down the road. If you get into it a lot, it's something I would have thought of over the years, you know, of doing this, that could happen eventually. So it did get me for a short time, I would say.
And the dog spirits, huh?
Yeah, well, it kind of knocked me down for a while, but after a few weeks, you know, I just started building back up again, I would say. Well, in fact, the experience did make me want to go at it a lot harder, because in a way, what I'm trying to do through promotion of free radio is to make it so that if some kind of free broadcast band would be open, then I would be able to get back on. So in a way, it's helping me out if I would promote it, in addition to being angry about what happened and saying that they can't do this to me, in my mind anyway.
What would you do different today?
Use bigger trends.
I don't know. Well, that's true. I would probably say make it more worth my while.
Yeah, like, really.
In other words, that every broadcast had better be good, and not just a few tests going on the air.
Well, really.
At times, and going on and saying nothing.
Yeah, whenever you got busted, nobody really heard it.
Nobody heard it except that.
Yeah, that's the bad part.
That's
you're
true.
On with 20 watts, and you got to make it worth your while sometimes.
I'd say so. I would think, you know, I'd go for like 100 watts now, maybe. But actually, for what happened in the past, though, I can't really say, because when you, in my philosophy anyways, when you look at the past and you say you could have done something better, it's in a way, you know, grieving.
You don't have
it.
Any regrets.
No, I don't. Not at all. Not in what I had done, because that's a natural process of the evolution of me as a broadcaster.
Yeah.
As a free radio broadcaster.
No two weeknights in a row.
Don't make a regular pattern, mate. Really look for patterns. Try to move your transmitter as much as possible.
Or whatever you
can.
Yeah,
move
do.
Frequency, move transmitters, get relays. Do what you can to make them think that you're not in one place for a long time.
And move to a farm.
Move to a farm.
That's probably one of
with
the best
big
places.
Guns. And a big dog under your antenna.
Landmines.
Yeah, landmines. But the only thing you can really do to keep it from them finding you is try to make it as mobile or as portable as possible. Move it. Don't use one place too many times. Try not to get on frequencies where you're in strategic command frequencies or something ridiculous like that. Try to pick a clean frequency where nobody's at. That helps a little bit, not much.
Oh, okay. Well, probably the best way is not to broadcast. Don't pirate if you don't want to get busted. But there are a lot of good things you can do to not get busted. Let's try to think of a few. One thing is to not go on for 24 hours at a time. That's a pretty safe thing to do. The best thing to do is to keep it down to 20 minutes, half an hour, maybe 45 minutes. And come on sporadically. couple times per month, maybe once a month, whatever. That keeps it down. If you want to become a big station that people listen to every day, you're going to get busted. You're going to get the publicity, you're going to get the name, and you're going to get busted. A couple other good things you can do are broadcast with power generators. Get out a generator, go somewhere, and do it. That way you won't get... you'll be in different locations each time. You won't be at your house. Some other people hook up power inverters to their car and get little whip antennas and hook them on the back, and they drive around in their car, and that really screws things up. I don't know, but remember, I don't advocate pirate radio, and I just listen, and you should just listen too if you want to abide by the laws of this country. But if you are going to go about pirating, you should do one of those things and not just broadcast from your house, because if you broadcast from your house, unless you live in a rural location, chances are you're going to wipe out somebody's TV set. That's the worst thing you can do, is wipe out somebody's TV set or come over somebody's telephone. If you do that, you're going to have the people complain to someone, probably the FCC, and the FCC goes about on their work trying to bust stations, especially if somebody complains. Complaints really get it, and old ham radio equipment seems to wipe out TVs and telephones pretty well. And if you're really close by someone, if you're in an apartment building, you shouldn't broadcast from the apartment building. You're going to wipe out half the people's TV sets in the apartment building. They're going to get mad. They're going to be watching Wheel of Fortune. And the old ladies who have nothing better to do and they hear some pirate saying something like, this is the voice of the universe, they're going to get mad and you're going to be meat. And there are other people who've wiped out people's telephones, and you get some old lady or old man, not to be sexist, who has nothing better to do than complain about things. And if they get their phone wiped out, you know they're going to be complaining, so don't do that. You're a lot better off going out somewhere and doing it from someplace safe. Or if you live in a rural location, home isn't so bad, especially if you got some really mean dogs.
Okay, what we just did is we took the antenna, we took the one end, it's a coax cable, as you can see.
All back.
One end's going into the transmitter down here, right into the back of the, it has a PL259 connection.
Right.
The other side, we got running up to a center split. I don't know if you can see that.
Come on back.
The hot end, which would be the center of the coax.
You know what?
Coax, the way it's made, it has a couple leads in the center. The rest is around the outside. The center part branches off and goes to the high point. And you want that to your high point, otherwise
because
you're going to ground your signal.
That's where your signal's mostly coming out of.
And the other end is the
ground lead.
The ground lead.
Sort of.
And we have it on a slope formation in which it will come down. And
it's
being attached to the back of a car. An older style receiver, FRG7, made by Yaesu, more officially termed as the Frog 7. It's a general coverage receiver. You catch AM all the way up through FM or whatever.
Take surface in the videos.
Andrew's now checking the bands to see if there's any other pirates on at the time, and if the band's clear for us to go on.
131. And the number you wish to call is 1-800 toll-free number, 1-800-255-5659. That's 255-5659.
Yeah,
you have reserved the talking today. And what formats is this available in? This video, VHS, Beta, 8mm, what?
I got
an
Okay, as you can hear, this is on the air. We don't have any antenna connected up or anything connected to the receiver or the transmitter. And some signals being bounced off the antenna above us. Turned down a little bit. We had a little bit of problems on this broadcast. The microphone jack, which we got going in from the tape player, was having a little bit of problems. See, we did a little fast wiring here. But then on the inside, when it was converted at another point in time before we had purchased this, connections got weak and kind of frazzled on us. But now we're back online thanks to a little bit of searching and finding the air.
Frequency we're on.
Okay, we're on frequency 7415. Is that kilohertz or megahertz? I always forget. Kilohertz. 7415 kilohertz. And the reason we're on that is a very popular band for pirates. What you're going to want to be looking for pirates, that's when the first channels you're going to want to look at. Then you're going to want to look at somewhere between 7350, where you hear the Canadian time atomic clock, all the way up to 7500. It's a good range to look for. You're going to find a lot of pirates in that area if you're going to find them anywhere. Some like to go on 6800 to 6950. Some like to go higher bands in the 15,000 range for distance. But right now we're doing 7415 because it's popular and it's going to get us out in a wide range. And if you're ever going to check, that's the first place you should look. If the FCC would come right now, I can't really say what we would do. I got the transmitter, it's hot right next to me, and it's pretty obvious that we're doing something about it.
With a little fun. The speaker was an impudent young mongrel known as
the volume. Radio Animal.
Why not forget your troubles with a little fun? The speaker was an impudent young mongrel known as
the volume. Radio Animal.
Forget your troubles with a little fun. The speaker was an impudent young mongrel known as
Radio Animal.
Anyone who is there, become a public follower of Christ.
Follower of Christ? What's going on? I don't think so. You got the it's on 7. You can't do it. What?
Anarchy on the air.
The human voice is powerful. It can connect to the listener in a very personal way.
This is the voice of redemption.
WPST, the Beat in Salem, Massachusetts.
You have just heard another broadcast from Radio Clandestine as we work you over the airwaves of the world.
You are listening to Radio USA. Free radio on shortwave. And you're still listening to Happy Days Radio on 27.355 megahertz in the 11 meter band.
This is Tangerine Radio, the voice of anarchism.
This is a fantasy broadcasting station shutting down for the night. Not all.
It has been said that freedom of the press is afforded only to those who own one.